On Thursday, Bob sat down at the table, his gaze riveted on the bottle of Miller Lite in front of him. He decided to take only 6 bottles, realizing that he did not want to get too drunk if the situation suddenly took a different turn. When the music stopped upstairs, he realized that his wife had almost finished packing her things. Bob usually worked late on Thursdays because his wife and her friends had hen parties. His parents would pick up their daughter Casey, and his wife would go out for a drink with colleagues. At this time, Bob stayed at work doing paperwork so that he could leave early on Friday and be with his family. Everything seemed to have been carefully planned. He found time in his busy work schedule. His parents enjoyed tinkering with their granddaughter, and his wife enjoyed socializing with friends. At least, that's what he thought. When his wife went to the bathroom, he remembered having lunch with Vicky last Tuesday. He thought about how delicious their sandwiches were and decided that he needed to go to the store more often or explore delivery options. Crouching down so as not to lose sight of the door, he noticed a familiar figure entering the restaurant. Bob stood up and waved. She noticed him and walked towards him. At 31, Vicky was the oldest of Bob's wife's ex-girlfriends. Bob liked her, especially since she was the only one who was already married. Vicky had a special ability to smooth things out without being annoying. Bob couldn't deny that her dark wavy hair and fair skin made her very attractive. Although she wasn't the best at chess, her beauty and long legs more than made up for it. Vicky's husband Ron considered her a blessing from above, and Bob couldn't disagree with him. Sitting across from him, she expressed her gratitude to Bob for taking the time to meet. "I know you're very busy, Bob, so I appreciate you taking the time for me," she said, meeting his gaze. Bob nodded his thanks. "No problem, Vicky," he replied. "But I have to admit that meeting without Sharon seems a little strange to me. I usually prefer to have lunch with my wife, but when it comes to something related to Sharon, I'm all attention. I suppose you're planning to surprise her for her birthday next month." Bob was stunned by the sadness he saw in Vicky's eyes. "When it comes to our lunch and Sharon's birthday, Bob, I see that you and Sharon love each other. It's undeniable. I've seen enough to know how strong your relationship is. That's why I'm here. Maybe our friendship will end, but if it means saving your marriage, I'm ready." Bob was shocked. "It must be a joke and a very scary one," he told Vicky. "I'm sorry, Bob, but this is very serious. Ever since you started working on this project 3 months ago, Sharon has been feeling depressed. She was sullen at work and showed no interest. After a few drinks, she confessed that she misses you and feels neglected. According to her, it seems to her that you are just fulfilling your duties as a middle-aged spouse, letting life slip away." At that moment, the waiter came to take Vicky's order, and she chose a Cobb salad and tea with lemon and ice. Bob's thoughts were preoccupied with his wife's silence throughout the 8 years of marriage. He was sure that she would always trust him. If she was unhappy, they were always open and honest with each other, even when they disagreed. Turning to Vicky, he urgently asked in a whisper, "Did she sleep with him?" Vicky replied, "As far as I know, no. Your wife is usually very open about everything. That's why I'm surprised by her behavior, Bob. There's something you should know. All the women I talked to expressed similar feelings. I can assume that both of you often talk about feeling overwhelmed by the demands of everyday life," Vicky explained. "When Sharon mentioned this, we all sympathized with her and said that she is a wonderful woman who deserves more attention from you. Unfortunately, my sister was there that night." "What does your sister have to do with this?" Bob asked, barely able to contain his anger. The waiter serving her tea raised an eyebrow. Vicky took a sip before continuing, "Our parents were unfaithful to each other. Although I do not know which of them cheated first, their relationship was filled with a desire to take revenge on each other. When I was 17, I wondered why they were staying together. But they brushed me off, saying their love was all that mattered. This situation has affected my sister and me in different ways. I thought she was defeating ruined relationships, whereas my sister thought it was acceptable if there was love. I love her, but she's deluded. My sister Gail advised them to look for love outside of a relationship if she couldn't find it at home. I disagreed with her, but then Hannah and Gail started talking about finding a new partner and hiding it. I suppose they discussed it hypothetically, especially since they are not married. Sharon said she would never change, but I'm afraid that her sister's words might have raised doubts in her, Bob asked, not being sure of Sharon's loyalty. He began to analyze the situation further. Although the information revealed to him was difficult to digest, Bob firmly believed in the importance of knowledge. The following week, Luke Jonas and his team showed up at the Red Horse Bar. Sharon insisted that she had not invited him but mentioned plans for a group dance. Although it's usually nice when more people join new events, it's not in the presence of Luke. After learning the name, Bob realized the truth of the saying, "Knowledge is power." Vicky noticed Bob's confident manner, chuckled slightly, and continued, "Luke Jonas has a reputation for stalking women. He is actively looking for every woman showing interest in anyone who succumbs to his charm. He makes no distinction based on marital status or attractiveness, but simply enjoys the excitement of the chase. Your wife caught his attention earlier, but he didn't pursue her until tonight. Now he is actively pursuing her, and she, instead of confronting him, prefers to avoid him. It is widely known that if Luke is accused of another inappropriate harassment, he will be fired from his position. Despite the possibility of ending his courtship, she prefers not to do so. In the last few months, they have often been seen talking in the cafeteria. When I tried to bring up the subject, she became defensive, claiming that they were just friends and that Luke was a good listener who understood her problems. I asked her if she would behave the same way if you were around, and she blushed, admitting that she wouldn't. Then she got upset, mentioning that she felt unnoticed by you. After that, I stepped aside and began to watch her closely. Everything seemed to calm down at work, and I thought everything was back to normal, until that event happened 3 weeks ago. When the food arrived, Vicky began to eat. Bob, watching her closely, took a sip of lemonade. His mind was occupied with other things. He couldn't understand why she thought he would be bothered by her flirting with another man. He knew that he did not feel an excessive sense of possessiveness because he fully believed in and loved his wife. Reflecting on the fact that he hadn't been paying attention to her, he wondered if he was getting too carried away with his work project. In the end, he would receive a substantial reward, but perhaps he had gone too far. The incident that happened 3 weeks ago continued to haunt him with curiosity. Was he ready to get to the truth? Bob and Vicky sat in silence for the next 5 minutes, giving him a chance to digest her revelations. Undoubtedly, he was upset. She had no excuse for such a close relationship with another man. And yet, to some extent, he could understand her reasoning. If he had been more attentive, perhaps this situation could have been avoided. By not revealing her flirtatious actions, she was, in fact, deceiving him. Ignoring her lies, he decided to sort out the situation and talk to her about what was bothering him. If she was honest and wanted to distance herself from Luke, they could solve this problem. He was sure they could handle it if nothing serious had happened in the last 3 weeks. With this attitude, he gained a sense of stability and was ready to cope with whatever happened. Vicky looked at him sympathetically. "That's where things take a turn for the worst, Bob," she said. "3 weeks ago, we found ourselves back at the Red Horse Bar to dance. Luke and his buddies came over, and we had a great time dancing together. Sharon drank more than usual, and Luke constantly bought her drinks, as a result of which she became very drunk. I took her to the bathroom and saw that she was even more intoxicated than I expected. When she came out of the toilet, she clutched her underwear in her hand, saying that she wanted to feel free. Being already drunk, I attributed her actions to alcohol and escorted her back to our table. I tried to convince Hannah and Gail to help me take Sharon to my place so that she would not return home in a state of severe intoxication. But my attention was attracted by Sharon and Luke, who were comfortably sitting, bumping into each other, and playfully imitating intimate actions on the dance floor. After the group dancing ended, the rest of the night seemed blurry to me. I saw Sharon put the laundry in Luke's pocket when the song ended, to everyone's amusement at the bar. Luke smiled broadly and leaned in for a passionate kiss. A friend captured this moment on his phone. I wanted Sharon to refuse, but she agreed. When she saw Bob's reaction, she apologized and said she was very sorry. His mouth was open in shock, which made him apologize and go to the toilet, stuttering. He shut himself inside to collect his thoughts. As he splashed water on his face and held onto the sink tightly, he was flooded with memories of the night when Sharon returned home late again, this time at 2:30 a.m. After Vicky called and said she would stay with her because of excessive alcohol consumption, which happened more than once, Bob was always grateful to Vicky and the girls for not letting Sharon drive drunk. Remembering how intense their intimacy had been that evening, he noticed a change in her behavior, felt betrayed by her apparent arousal for another man, and anticipated conflict when he returned home. "What if she was thinking about him while we were together?" he asked himself. Gathering his strength, he returned to the table, noticing the sympathy in Vicky's expression, but not knowing how to react. The untouched sandwich lay in front of him as he pressed for details. Vicky simply replied honestly, "Bob, that's it. The last bachelorette parties were at Hannah's." Vicky noticed that Sharon seemed to have distanced herself from Luke, despite the fact that he continued to pursue her. As soon as Vicky thought that their relationship was over, she saw that they were talking just yesterday. Their conversation ended abruptly when she approached, leaving Vicky unaware of what was really going on between them. "I thought you should know because she doesn't listen to her friends anymore," Vicky explained. When the waiter brought the bill, Bob quickly grabbed it, groping for his credit card. "I would like to observe their communication," he suggested. "This week, you ladies will go to the Red Square Bar on Thursday. When you go, I'll be watching them from the sidelines," he said, and suddenly stopped when he noticed the worried expression on Vicky's face. "What did I say wrong?" Bob asked. Vicky explained, "Hannah has to go to the doctor on Friday morning, and Gail is going to her brother's in Florida. If Sharon comes out on Thursday, we won't be with her." Vicky reached across the table and took his hand. "I'm so sorry, darling," she said bitterly. "I know it's probably not the best idea to ask how you're doing, but here's my home phone. Call me anytime to talk to Ron or me," Vicky suggested. Her husband was a marriage counselor, so talking to him might be helpful. "Thank you for telling me about this, Vicky. I know it was hard for you, but I truly believe that you are a good woman and a good friend. I do not know what the future holds for us, but I am aware of the current situation and can take some steps. Thanks again." Bob expressed his gratitude, paid the bill, and left. Today was an important milestone in Bob's project. They successfully secured the supply of finished parts from a startup company in Harrisburg. This achievement not only reduced the preparation time for work by 2 months, but also guaranteed at least a week's supply despite problems with unstable transport logistics. 2 more phone calls and the whole plan could have been completed 2 months ahead of schedule, which would have saved the military millions of dollars. In addition, Bob was counting on a substantial cash bonus and an improved reputation due to the success of the project. He should have been happy like a cat full of cream. But instead, he thought about how he didn't want to go home and solve problems that he knew needed to be solved. Deciding to get to the bottom of it, he decided to take matters into his own hands. Although he didn't have access to her work email, he was skeptical that they were using it to communicate as the HR department was monitoring it. He tried logging into her Yahoo mail, but found nothing suspicious. Perhaps she had a secret account that he could only find out about by logging into their home computer. Bob admitted his ignorance of technology, realizing that the idea of buying security cameras or installing voice control microphones looked attractive in theory. Despite this, he developed a plan. His goal was to gather as much information as possible to assess the efforts needed to save or end a marriage. Sharon had already taken their daughter Casey from her parents and asked him to deliver Chinese food. When he asked how she felt, She replied that after 10 years of marriage and 8 years of married life, he should already know that she loved him. Bob couldn't resist retorting sarcastically that he just wanted to make sure she was still happy with everything. Sharon asked for an extra dish. If it wasn't for the explosive news, he would have been glad to return home early and spend time with his wife and child. Glancing at his watch, he was still in shock. He realized that according to the project, this hour should have come 2 hours later. It dawned on him that he hadn't been home with his family so early on Friday since the start of the project. Fatigue and stress helped him realize that Sharon might feel left out, even though it didn't justify her actions. Entering through the front door, he saw his wife reaching for a bottle of wine. He paused, admiring her figure. At 31, she was the epitome of femininity. She was just over 5 feet tall, and her curves were seductive even in loose sweatpants. After tying her hair into a ponytail, she turned to him, giving him a radiant smile, and he felt incredibly lucky to have her. But then reality caught up with him. "I'm so glad you're home, honey. How's work going?" She went up to him and kissed him on the lips. "Very good. We have managed to achieve a significant breakthrough in supplies, so we will be able to finish the project at least a month ahead of schedule, my love. I realize that I've been away from home a lot lately because of this project. I wish I could share all the details because they are classified, but please know that you and Casey are my top priorities, and I will do everything to ensure our safety," he assured, looking deeply into her eyes. Was there a hint of regret or guilt in her gaze, or is she just thinking too much? He often cursed his inability to read people, preferring straightforward communication. He believed in honesty and scrupulousness, and this method served him well for 34 years. He saw no reason to change it now. "Oh, my dear," she replied. "We both love you and understand. I wish you were around more often, but I know it's temporary. Still, I appreciate your recognition." She seemed close to tears. Was she really touched, or was she just putting on a show? "And how will completing the project as soon as possible help you?" she asked, taking food containers out of her bag. "First of all, it means that a significant bonus will be added to my salary. The exact amount has not yet been determined before the approval of the project, but it is definitely not small. In addition, the successful completion of our first government project may bring additional orders to the company. As a project manager, I can offer lucrative opportunities to government contractors who need my help. If everything goes according to plan, it can be very profitable," he clarified, trying to eat sweet and sour pork with chopsticks and then switching to a fork. "Didn't I say this before?" he asked between bites. "As far as I remember, no, my dear," she replied. "All I remember is that you were talking about some important contract that was classified but sounded promising. It looks like we haven't talked since then," she said with a slight sadness, but immediately brightened up. "But it looks like my husband will be back soon," she added in an even brighter tone. He looked at her. "So, which bar are you ladies going to tomorrow night? Maybe I should stop by after work to make sure you're okay and can go home," he asked in a casual manner. "Actually, we decided to go to the Red Horse Bar to dance with friends, but I think we'll finish before you finish work," she replied. Just at this time, Casey finished her egg roll and asked her father to tell her bedtime stories. He put the plate away, rinsed it in the sink, and then picked up his daughter and carried her into the living room. For the next hour, he read her story after story until she fell asleep. There was a soft snoring from the sofa, and he saw his wife curled up with a book on her lap. Carefully taking his daughter in his arms, he went upstairs to put her to bed. He carefully tucked his daughter in, making sure that she was comfortably ensconced under the covers. When he thought about the difficulties they would have to face the next day, tears welled up in his eyes. He hoped that his daughter would keep the memories of those quiet evenings with her parents and not about the upcoming difficulties. Wiping away his tears, he quietly went downstairs to where his wife was sleeping on the couch. He kissed her gently on the lips and covered her with a blanket to keep her warm. He then went to look for her phone and found it charging on the bedside table in their bedroom. After unlocking his phone, he began to look through her text messages. It didn't take him long to find what he was looking for. Scrolling back, he traced their conversations over the past 3 months. He came across a message that caught his attention. "Hello, pretty girl. It was fun watching you at the girls' dance last night," Luke wrote. Similarly, Bob works late on Thursdays, and the in-laws look after Casey, so we had a bachelorette party, she replied. "Your husband seems like a good guy to let you have fun," he replied. "Yes, he's wonderful," she confirmed. The messages remained friendly for a while, until one conversation stood out. "Today, Vicky talked to me about our lunch breaks. I was annoyed, but she was right about everything," he agreed and said. "That's right. I don't want any confusion," she noted. Vicky asked if Bob approved of our behavior, and it made me realize that we might be sending the wrong signal. "I also think I shouldn't share all my problems with another guy. I have to talk to Bob about this," he reassured her by saying. "I understand. But if you can't talk to him, you can always come to me, and I'll even invite you to dinner if you want, just as a friend." Bob didn't remember her trying to talk to him. But maybe that's when he realized he needed food-grade stainless steel for the project. When he spent several days looking for a supplier who could provide the required quantity of products, he was so focused that he would not have noticed if a bomb had exploded next to him. If you recall her messages, they all seemed harmless. It was quite clear to him that this fool was flirting with her. How could she be so inconsiderate? As he continued flipping through the pages, he came across the next set of messages. "She, you have to return them today." "He, what are you talking about?" "She, you know perfectly well that my friends are mad at me. And I don't blame them. If Bob finds out that I've been acting inappropriately, he might leave me." "He, so you don't want me to show him the video?" "She, I can't let anyone at work see this. Sam was present and recorded the video on his phone. I'll make sure he deletes it, but you owe me." "He, okay. I can't lose Bob. Not after last night." "She, what happened last night?" "He, is he upset that you came home late and drunk?" "She, no. Something happened that turned everything upside down." "He, so, dancing with me, you ask your husband for forgiveness." "She, you're disgusting. Last night was unforgettable because Bob and I love each other. Now, give me back my underwear and make sure the video is erased. Damn it, it sounded like I was some kind of woman. Bob deserves better than me." "He, no, he's lucky to have you. He looked out for you, didn't he?" "She, I don't need anyone to take care of me. Just be the friend you pretend to be and do what I ask you to do, please." He said, "I'll help you. And then you'll buy me dinner." She replied, "Just make sure no one sees this video, and I'll do whatever you ask." There was nothing else until last Monday. "He, I heard that the bachelorette party was canceled. How about we have dinner together?" "She, this is not a good idea. I'm sorry." "He, come on. Your husband will be at work, and the girls left you for one evening with a friend. We can meet in the cafeteria just like in the good old days, and you owe me." She said, "Okay. I'll meet you at the Red Horse at 8. "He, no, I'll meet you at the TGIF located at the Sheridan Hotel. They have great booze, and I don't want to deal with drunken idiots. If we drink too much, I'll get a room." "She, okay, but it's just dinner with a friend. And I'm grateful to you that the video didn't come up. It's bad that they found out about it at work. Sam has already deleted the video, and soon someone else will commit some scandalous act and distract attention." They agreed to meet at 8. Bob thought about it and realized that this could be the beginning of the end of his marriage. *Story 2*. How many times has he seen his wife go on dates with other men in the hotel restaurant bar? How could this situation lead to a positive result? How could she not think about intimacy? Closing the messages on his phone, he plugged it into the charger, undressed, and climbed into bed alone. He couldn't sleep that night. When Thursday came, she came down the stairs in her little black dress, which she always wore when they went out together. She looked absolutely gorgeous. She noticed him sitting at the table and was surprised by his early arrival. "I didn't expect you to come back so soon, baby," she said, her voice trembling. "We need to talk, Sharon," he replied evenly. "This conversation is extremely important. Please sit down." She sat up nervously and reached for his hand, but he pulled it away. "I know there won't be a bachelorette party today. I know you're dating Luke Jonas behind my back," he began. "Let me explain." But he interrupted her by slamming his fist down on the table. "Darn it, Sharon, listen to me," he shouted, his voice full of frustration. "You can't talk until I'm done." Sharon recoiled, tears starting to form in her eyes. He looked at her coldly before continuing. "I know you kissed that fool at lunch. I know you danced with him at the Red Horse Bar. I know that you even took off your underwear and gave it to him after a few seductive moves on the dance floor. I know that your sudden interest in me 3 weeks ago was caused by your excitement over him. Tonight, you have a date with him at the hotel bar where your boyfriend has a table reserved. I do not know if you have already had an intimate relationship with him. And I do not know what can prevent you from doing this." He paused, trying to contain his anger. "Sharon, you deceive me by hiding information about Luke, your risky behavior, and going to your friends. To be honest, I'm devastated and my faith in you is undermined. I'm not sure I want to save our marriage, and it looks like you're not aiming for it anymore either. That's why I'm offering you three options." He held up one finger. "The first option is that you can leave and be with your lover. Even if you don't do anything tonight, this decision will mean the end of our marriage, and I won't want to save it." Then he held up a second finger. "The second option, we've been sitting all evening while you're trying to convince me to make an effort to save our marriage. The task before you will not be easy because it is difficult for me to trust everything you say. Despite this, I have a glimmer of hope because my love for you and for our child is of great importance to me." He admitted that there was a 50% chance he would be willing to try the third option. "Option 3, you take me with you to meet your lover and demand in front of my eyes that he never speak or contact you again. After that, you will give me the opportunity to talk to him alone for at least 15 minutes away from strangers. This gesture will show maximum respect and increase my willingness to cooperate with you. If you haven't had any intimate relations with him, then I guarantee that I will fully devote myself to making our relationship a success. But if you got intimate with him, then this may not be a chance to save our marriage." She looked like she was about to throw up, her expression pure horror. The question hung in the air for what seemed like an eternity. She seemed to be holding back the urge to vomit as she looked at him. "Bob, I'm sorry for everything, and I really need to talk to you," she said urgently. "As for your question, who will be driving, you or me?" He was stunned by her unexpected choice. He assumed that she would spend the whole evening trying to justify her actions. By agreeing to meet her lover, she earned a few points, but she was still deeply wounded. He took the keys and followed her to the car without hesitation. Opening the door for her, she was on the verge of tears. When he pulled out onto the road, she looked at him. "I ruined everything, didn't I?" she asked quietly. "Yes, Sharon, you really messed up," Bob replied, focusing on the road. "What can I do to fix this?" she asked. He thought for a moment. He had several ideas in his head. "Well, first of all, from now on, complete honesty. It goes without saying, but it seems like you think it's okay to withhold information that I need to know or constantly deceive me. Besides, you have to find a way to earn my trust. I don't know how you plan to do this, but to be honest, I didn't break the trust. There is one more point that, in my opinion, does not require clear wording, but still, I will say it. He is no longer a part of your life. If we're going to continue our relationship, you shouldn't talk to him at work. You don't need to ask how his day went. If he ends up in the same bar as you, you need to leave. If you can't leave, contact me immediately. You refuse to accept drinks or gifts from him and completely stop all communication, no matter what he says. When we get back tonight, you'll tell me everything. I admit that I was too absorbed in this project, and I will take on some of the responsibility. If you have any grudges against me, please express them. And finally, sign up for a marriage counseling session. If you want to choose a consultant yourself, don't be shy. Ron can recommend someone to you. After Bob finished speaking, a message suddenly came to her phone. She glanced at it quickly, and her face turned even paler. "It's him, wondering where I am," she whispered softly. Bob held out his hand, and she handed him the phone without saying a word. He started scrolling through her text messages. There were several messages sent earlier that day. "Heath, hi. I've booked a room with a jacuzzi. Maybe we can relax after lunch. Take a bikini with you. She, you can't get me drunk enough to take a hot bath with you. I'm not taking a bikini with me. He will see. You know what happens when you drink. Maybe you won't need a bikini." The message followed. "Where are you?" "While I was waiting for you, I decided to have a glass of wine." Bob replied, "I'm a little late. I have a surprise for you." "He, you must have brought a bikini with you." Bob returned the phone to his wife. She read the messages and just hung her head. "You do realize that these messages won't help you in your case, right? Judging by today's messages, you have already planned to meet with him tonight. How much worse will it look if I scroll further?" he asked, realizing how terrible it would be. "I have to ask," Bob began. "Do you think your messages today have crossed the line of inappropriate flirting? Can you understand that these conversations have completely destroyed my trust in you?" He heard her crying. "Bob, I swear I just wanted to have dinner tonight. I never had any intention of sleeping with him." But Bob couldn't help but look at her in disbelief. "Were you going to give him your underwear like you did a few weeks ago after you took them off?" He didn't think she could get any paler, but it turned out that Bob was wrong. "Sharon, we've almost reached our destination. You should touch up your makeup and prepare for what you're going to say to Luke, and please refrain from whining," he said as he lowered the visor and took a napkin out of the glove compartment, gaining her strength and wiping away her tears. She carefully applied mascara. In a calmer voice, she asked Bob, "I understand why you think Luke is playing games with me. When you brought it up, I realized that you were right. But Bob, how could I not have noticed that, despite my recent decisions, which may indicate otherwise, I am not a naive girl. I've rejected more attractive and sophisticated men than Luke, so why did he choose me?" "That's one of the reasons I find it hard to believe what you're saying right now, Sharon. You are a beautiful, intelligent woman who should be able to see through this deception. Imagine if I picked up some woman in a bar and then lied to you that I was going to have dinner with her tonight. No wonder you feel so angry and resentful," Bob expressed. Her complexion seemed to have returned to normal, and her voice was a little stronger. "Okay, I made a mistake, and now I have to figure out how to fix it. Thank you for giving me another chance," she said, bending down to kiss her husband, but he turned his head at the last moment, allowing her to kiss his cheek. "I won't get over this easily, not in the long run," Bob said. She looked at him in surprise. They were usually very affectionate. "I hope we can work things out in the end. What should I tell them?" she asked as they drove up to the restaurant and found a parking spot. Bob turned off the car and tried to contain his anger. "What do I want you to tell him, Sharon? Our relationship is on edge because of what you did with that fool. You've destroyed the foundation of our marriage. Maybe our daughter will spend Thanksgiving with you and Christmas with me. I need you to understand this, so tell him whatever you think is necessary." After a moment of silence, she sighed and opened the car door. When they reached the restaurant and the hotel, she made a barely noticeable gesture as if wanting to take her husband's hand. He didn't resist, but he didn't reciprocate either. When they entered the restaurant, the red-haired hostess greeted them from behind the counter and asked if they had booked a table together. Before Bob could answer, his wife intervened in the conversation, mentioning that they were meeting someone who had already arrived. The waitress confirmed her remark and offered to show them to the table. Since Bob didn't know what this man looked like, he followed his wife. She gave her husband a gentle nudge and pointed toward the back of the restaurant, where a man was sitting at the door of the hotel, engrossed in his phone. With purposeful steps, she approached the table and stopped without sitting down. The man looked up, saw her, and smiled broadly. It was only when he noticed Bob standing behind her that his expression changed. The smile disappeared, and his eyes narrowed slightly. "He's worried about our relationship, and I have to admit that after our conversation, I share his concerns. For the first time in our marriage, I gave him reason to doubt my loyalty. I am determined to correct the breach of trust that was caused by my association with you. I don't want to have any more contact with you. Please refrain from calling, texting, or any other contact with me. I take full responsibility for the current state of our relationship and have decided to put an end to it. My husband now knows about my unseemly actions at the Red Horse Bar. I intend to do everything possible to fix our relationship with him. I will report this whole situation to the Human Resources Department tomorrow. I will tell them that any attempts to involve me in non-work-related conversations will be undesirable. While my husband is talking to you, I'll sit at the bar," she concluded, giving Bob a quick kiss on the cheek. She apologized softly, her eyes briefly meeting her husband's. When she left, Bob felt relieved. Surprisingly, the situation was resolved even better than he had hoped. When he sat down opposite the shy playboy, Bob couldn't help but appreciate him. With his dark hair, slender figure, and impeccable fashion sense, one could argue that he was attractive, but the ability to evaluate men had never been his strong suit. It was difficult to determine his height when he was sitting, but he caught his lingering gaze at the glass of wine in front of him, which only strengthened his suspicions. Bob needed to keep his composure and think about what to do. He had an idea of exactly what he wanted, but he would have to improvise as the conversation progressed. Bob was not a quick thinker. "So you decided it would be a surprise to see her in a bikini," Bob said with a half-smile. "Do you really think she told you everything?" he replied, grinning. Now that he was standing in front of Bob, he felt calm. It was a situation he could handle. "Actually, yes. I've known her for 10 years and been married to her for 8 years. I think I understand her better than some cute guy who's been stalking her for 3 months now," Bob said, keeping a smile on his face. The waiter came up and asked if they could bring drinks. Bob asked for a double Johnny Walker Black on the rocks. "She definitely knows how to please a man," he said with a grin. Luke looked at the glass of wine he had ordered for her. "Yes, it's true this time," Bob replied, grinning broadly. "But I don't think you're talking based on your experience," Luke joked. "Do you need photos then?" he laughed. Luke was trying to provoke Bob. Bob resisted the urge to reach across the table and instead just laughed. "You don't have any photos. If she had gone that far with you, you wouldn't have had to put something in her drink. What do potential violators use these days?" Bob's guess was confirmed by Luke's surprised reaction. He recoiled when Bob leaned closer to him at the table. Anger surged through him. "You disgusting coward. I have to teach you a lesson right here and now, but I can't risk going too far. I don't want to end up in jail. I offered my wife 3 options, and now I'm offering the same to you." Bob pointed a determined finger at him. "First of all, you will leave immediately. You will apologize to my wife right now and quit your job tomorrow. I won't take revenge, but you have to leave the city. Secondly, admit to the police that you drugged my wife. You'll do your time, and then you'll stay away from my wife. I'll keep an eye on you, but I won't touch you. I've signed us both up for boxing classes, which will start in 4 weeks. We will enter the ring, sign injury waivers, and not leave until we both run out of steam. And when you come to your senses, you'd better stay away from my wife. Then you will leave the city." While Bob was talking, the waiter brought his whiskey. Bob took a deep sip, feeling the warmth of the alcohol. "It's time to collect my thoughts. You probably think I'm naive. Why would I agree to any of these options?" Luke chuckled. Bob returned his grin with what he hoped was a menacing look. because you don't want to spend the rest of your sad life constantly looking over your shoulder every time you walk to the car in the dark. You will be afraid that I or one of my accomplices is lurking nearby, ready to harm you. Every time you open the door, you won't be sure that I or one of my accomplices won't break in, detain you, and hurt you. When you go to the bar, you will be afraid that I or one of my friends will mix your drink and expose you to unspeakable actions before harming you. You won't take any chances. You're a coward. That's what your wife said after I met her last night, Bob said. The color returned to Luke's face as Bob took another sip of whiskey. He reached into his pocket and activated the voice recorder on his phone, hoping to record the conversation. Bob realized that he should have planned this evening better. You plan to drug my wife and attack her, you jerk. Are you willing to risk a lifetime of agony, assuming that I won't take action? It's time to confront Bob. The drugs were supposed to prepare her for the arrival of my friends. In a moment of desperation, Bob reached out and grabbed Luke by the collar, pulling him closer. Although he couldn't hit with full force while sitting, he still managed to hear a pleasant crunch when Luke's nose broke. Luke screamed, pinching his nose and threatening to call the police. Bob persistently persuaded him to call, calling him a fool and suggesting that the authorities check the wine in the glass and listen to the recording of his confession. Police arrived at the scene 10 minutes later as two officers were nearby having lunch on the subway. They quickly recorded Bob's testimony and took the remaining wine and glass for analysis. During the search, a bag of white powder was found near the hatch. When Bob was asked to provide additional information, Luke asked for a lawyer and declined further conversation. Then the police listened to the recording Bob made, confiscating Bob's phone as evidence. The footage showed Luke discussing illegal drugs and a possible attack. It was almost 4 a.m. before Bob and Sharon were finally allowed to leave the police station. After much thought, after her testimony, the officer praised Bob for almost 15 minutes and emphasized how he had prevented the attack on his wife. By the time he finished, she was visibly shaken. Luke was still with the police. They used her phone to promptly report the situation to Bob's parents. They calmed them down and took care of Casey, deciding to take her to the zoo. After parking in the garage and turning off the car, the couple met eyes. She unbuckled her seatbelt and pulled Bob to her, hugging him tightly. After letting her cry on his shoulder for a while, Bob gently pulled her aside. Sharon, we still need to talk, but it's too late. Let's get some rest. Tomorrow, we'll go to work and spend the day sorting things out. How does that sound? Yes, Bob, going to bed is great, she replied quietly. Can I sleep next to you? No, Sharon, going to bed is great, she replied quietly. Can I sleep next to you? No, Sharon, he said. The next morning, he woke up and saw her clinging to him. He allowed himself to believe that everything would get better in the end. Despite this, Bob understood that there were still several conversations to be held before making a decision. He understood that it was important not to rush things. Sitting up, Bob playfully patted her perfect buttocks before suggesting a walk. He didn't want to start a serious conversation on an empty stomach. Despite the temptation, Bob resisted until the problems were solved. The next morning, they had breakfast at the International Pancake House, discussing Casey and her upcoming visit to Bob's parents. The conversation was positive and easy. After finishing their coffee, they paid the bill and returned home. They sat down at the kitchen table and prepared to solve the problems that had arisen. I'll start, Bob said. I'm not going to talk about Luke's identity. You know who he is. He said that a few days ago, you satisfied him and called me a wimp. Is that true? No, she replied. The most negative communication with him was that ill-fated night at the Red Horse. I admit the seriousness of my behavior, but I didn't cross any boundaries. How can I trust you? Bob asked. You lied to me about a recent date with him and didn't reveal the details of that incident at the bar, not to mention your whole history with him. I found it necessary to be honest. I was thinking about it, and I got an idea, Bob said. How about taking a lie detector test? She asked. You mean the lie detector test? Bob confirmed. She nodded. Yes, let's appoint one. You can ask me anything. Just tell me when and where. Her sincerity was obvious. Bob knew that these tests are not always accurate, but it would be easier for him if they were true. I'll see what I can arrange. It may take some time, but it's worth thinking about, he said. Actually, it may take longer than expected, Bob added. She smiled. This is a good starting point. We can consider the extent of your involvement later. But my next question will probably be the most difficult. This is what causes me the most pain and has the greatest impact on a relationship. How do we live on? The underwear incident confused me, and I understand that I don't like it, but I understand. It's hard for me to accept that you got close to another guy without telling me about it. If you thought it was just a platonic friendship, I can sympathize with you. But what I can't understand, and what makes me pull away before I feel even more pain, is that you claim to be dating your friends when you actually had dinner with him. This blatant lie, without thinking about the consequences, shattered me to pieces. When you mentioned that you were dating another man, it was heartbreaking. Bob remembered how tears welled up in his eyes. He felt completely helpless. Bob, all I can do is try to explain my thoughts at that moment. First of all, I want to apologize for offending you with my lies. When you decided to take on this project, I couldn't help but feel that I wasn't important to you. I want to make it clear that I don't blame you or your job for this. I know how important this project is to you. I just wanted to share my feelings that I was feeling at that moment. I started to feel bad, and Vicky's sister made an offer that hooked me. She mentioned looking for romance elsewhere. I didn't want it to be perceived as cheating while you were absorbed in the project. I began to realize that I could find what I was looking for elsewhere, and then Luke intervened. I didn't understand it at first, but he managed to make me feel like an important person. He showed genuine interest in my daily life, family, and hobbies, making our conversations mostly focused on me. While Bob was trying to hide his emotions, she was watching him. It wasn't until Vicky bumped into me during lunch that I realized my actions. I used Luke to fill the void that I thought I couldn't find with you, but I still wanted to establish a relationship with you. That evening, when everything got out of control, I didn't plan to invite him or his friends. They arrived before my friends, and Luke even bought drinks for everyone, including me. I found myself more intoxicated than ever before. I have made some regrettable decisions that you are aware of, but we also shared an amazing night together, which made me feel even more conflicted. How could I be so reckless with him and share such wonderful moments with you? She stood up and poured herself a glass of water, taking a few sips before speaking. Then a video appeared. I foresaw your anger, and I understand why you are upset. If the situation had reversed, and you were kissing another woman while intoxicated, I would have been furious too. And I knew it would be even worse because after our passionate meeting, you'd be wondering if I was thinking about someone else. Trying to hide my mistake, I attracted Luke, feeling obligated. I agreed to go to dinner with him when my friends couldn't. I felt lonely, thinking that you wouldn't be home until late at night. In a moment of weakness, I made a terrible decision, and I deeply regret it. Our relationship has always been based on trust, and I destroyed it. Tears were streaming down her cheeks, but she remained calm. Bob knew she was hiding something. "Oh my God," he muttered. "We have not yet returned to what we were, but in time, we will be able to do it if you are ready to devote yourself completely to this." "Then so am I." Bob and Sharon went to counseling together, and solving his problems was a turning point. The most important lesson for him is that he didn't really know the woman he once married. The consultant advised Sharon to take a lie detector test, and she agreed, although Bob saw uncertainty in her eyes. After taking a lie detector test, Bob realized that what his wife had told him was a lie. He knew he wanted to see the video that Luke had mentioned. Bob visited him in the hope of finding out the whole truth and seeing a video with his wife. The conversation with Luke was tense, and for honesty, Luke demanded that Bob withdraw the charges against him. Bob had no choice but to agree to Luke's terms. He understood that if he did not find out the whole truth about Sharon, he would not be able to trust her. On the same day, Bob received a video in the mail from Luke's friend. Opening it on his computer brought tears to Bob's eyes. Shannon, Luke, and two of his friends engaged in intimacy in a hotel room. The whole process was filmed on a phone camera. It was obvious that Shannon was drunk, but she did not mind what was happening. She enjoyed intimacy with three men on the same day. Bob went to his office and replaced the locks in the bomb, while Shannon was at work. Bob was furious at the act of the woman he had given his life to. He dreamed of revenge. He wanted her to suffer while his daughter was with his parents. Bob posted an incriminating video on various adult websites and published it on social networks. This was going to be a complete failure for Shannon. He had one desire: to shield his daughter from all this. He decided to leave the state in the near future with his daughter. With all this, Bob did not keep his promise to Luke. He did not withdraw his accusation at the police station. The following weeks were difficult for Bob as he implemented his plan to leave the state. While Shannon was crying bitterly at her parents' house, Bob and Casey left town. The divorce was finalized, and Shannon was left without everything. Without a husband, without a daughter, without a home, and without means of subsistence. During these few weeks, Bob managed to make himself bankrupt, sell his house, and leave his unfaithful wife in poverty. Shannon had to decide for a long time how to live on because she was disgraced. Many friends and relatives knew about her intimacy with several men, not to mention those people who were not personally familiar with her. Shannon understood that she had hurt her husband, but she did not understand how he could do this to her. Her life turned into chaos. She was fired from her job, and she couldn't get another job because of her reputation. Shannon's nerves were thin. She drank a lot and stayed out of the house until a terrible thing happened. Intoxicated, she drove her father's car to Vicky's to say that she had brought her life into chaos. Shannon understood how Bob found out everything, but fate was not on her side. In an instant, Shannon's car twisted several times around itself. A terrible accident took her life. Bob and Casey stood over Shannon's grave and knew that she had come to this because of her own foolishness. Thanks to everyone who took the time to listen to today's stories. If you enjoyed it, please consider liking and subscribing if you haven't already. Feel free to share your thoughts on the events in the comments below. Take care.